Brooks Running has a new shoe for you runners out there. Did you hear that? Better turn up your volume. In fact, turn it up to the max. Introducing the all-new Ghost Max. It's got all kinds of things to make your knees and ankles feel protected, like Max Cushion, Max Soft Landings with DNA Loft V2 Foam, and Max Smooth Rides with their Glide Roll Rocker. Feel better on your run with Ghost Max. Learn more at brooksrunning.com.
Apple Gift Card is a practical gift that unlocks a world of entertainment and fun. You can send it via email or give a physical card to your loved ones. Your friends and family can spend it on their favorite Apple services, including Apple subscriptions. Apple Gift Card can be used to buy all things Apple. Products, accessories, apps, games, movies, TV shows, iCloud Plus, and more. Visit apple.com for details and to send Apple Gift Cards to your friends and family this holiday season.
Holistic Voice presents the Food Heals podcast with your hosts, Alison Melody and Susie Hardy. Join the Food Heals Nation and learn the secrets to go from feeling unwell to healing yourself.
Warning, side effects of this podcast may include increased health and vitality, thoughts of living longer, an increase in sexual activity, feelings of joy, cravings for kale and quinoa, and a spike in Tinder matches. In real cases, women have experienced a strong desire to stop asking their boyfriends if they look fat and stressed. If you experience any of these symptoms, post a selfie to Instagram immediately.
All right, welcome Food Heals Nation. Thanks so much for joining me. I'm Alison Melody. What if there was a simple treatment protocol that you could do at home without going to the hospital when you or a loved one got sick with COVID? That is what today's guest, Dr. Peter McCullough, is here to share. Dr. McCullough is an internist, a cardiologist, and an epidemiologist. Since the outset of the pandemic, Dr. McCullough has been a leader in the medical response to the COVID-19 disaster. McCullough is known for his iconic views on the state of medical truth in America and around the globe. And today, he's breaking it down for us, the data, the science, the stats, the facts, about where we are today with patient care and where we're going. And he's going to reveal the exact treatment protocol that you can do at home to avoid hospitalization or complications from COVID. But first, Food Heals Nation, what podcasts are you listening to these days? Besides Food Heals, of course, I want to recommend one of my faves. Katie Krimitsos is a friend of the show, and her amazing podcasts are literally a part of my daily routine. I can't recommend them enough. Katie creates guided meditations for sleep, for anxiety, for manifesting, for stepping into your power, so much more. I mean, that's not even doing it justice. Just go read some of the titles. You can listen when you want to start your day with a mindful intention, when you want to relieve stress or relieve anxiety, when you want to fall asleep easier, or simply tune in to the wisdom of your inner voice. Each meditation is created with love. Katie infuses all her love, and you can hear it. You can feel it. It's amazing. She wants to help you shine throughout all the seasons of your life. And I'm just personally obsessed with the sleep meditations. They do guide me to sleep most nights, and during my meditation time, I play them, and during my nap time, I play them to help me meditate into a nap, one of my favorite afternoon pastimes. And that is one of the many podcasts brought to you by the Women's Meditation Network. And you just sit back, relax, lay down, get comfortable, and let Katie's guided meditations help you ease into sleep peacefully. So you just get comfy, press play, let yourself be guided into dreamland. I just channeled Katie for a second there. And Katie's podcasts are available wherever you listen to podcasts. Get started right now at womensmeditationnetwork.com. All right, next up, my interview with Dr. McCullough. Roll it, Roxy.
The Food Heals Podcast starts now.
Food Heals Nation, please welcome Dr. McCullough to the show.
Hi, I'm Dr. Peter McCullough. It's so great to be on the program. I'm a practicing internist and cardiologist in Dallas, Texas. I practice non-invasive cardiology. I maintain my boards in both specialties. About half my time is in clinical practice, and the other half of the time is as an author, a clinical scholar. And in the last 2 years, I'm a frequent news commentator on COVID-19 as I've really focused my research efforts and my scholarship on the pandemic and how to best handle patients and try to help them through this difficult time.
Can you take us back before we get into the pandemic and how everything has changed for all of us, I want to hear a little bit about your background and why you went into cardiology and why are you passionate about health and helping people?
I grew up in Texas and went to Baylor undergrad and then the University of Texas Southwestern in Dallas. And from there, I went on to University of Washington in Seattle for my medicine training. And back in the 80s, it was common for graduates to do service. Many of my fellow colleagues went into the military or a center for disease control. I signed up for a rural health commitment, and I worked 3 years as a general practitioner in a remote area. And then in the third year of that, I combined it with training in public health at the University of Michigan. And so I think that experience really made me broad-based. And, you know, I've always just enjoyed seeing patients and trying to help them the best I can. As I moved into academics, I've picked an area that was relatively understudied, and that was how the heart and kidneys communicate with one another and how they interact with respect to both disease and health, and made some important contributions along the way. And I think in total now I have over 650 publications in the National Library of Medicine, PubMed. And that's the, you know, that's tops for doctors working in this field of cardiorenal medicine. Wow. So when COVID-19 hit, I saw a gap. I saw a void. There was a lot of panic. People are worried about masks and hand sanitizers and personal protective equipment, but no one was focusing on the sick patient. And people were getting sick at home. There appeared to be absolutely no advice for them on what they could do to try to basically avoid two bad outcomes. People have been, for 2 years now, been trying to avoid hospitalization or death. And I set out to try to find an approach to have people successfully get through the illness.
Why do you think it was? Because the most frustrating part for me was that no one was talking about how to boost your immune system naturally, or any type of nutritional protocol. Why do you think that was?
I think there was an oblivion with respect to prevention of hospitalization and death. Almost everybody went into a fear-based survival mode, particularly the doctors. The doctors were almost completely focused on locking down the hospital, shutting down the operating rooms, heart catheterization laboratories, closing down clinics, doing telemedicine. Most of it was, you know, how do the doctors and nurses avoid getting COVID? Well, those efforts did pay off. You know, there was never a single hospital outbreak of COVID among the workers in the United States, none. Mm. There was initially nursing home outbreaks, nursing home worker to patient transference of the virus. But after the first few months, you never even heard about the nursing homes. The nursing homes quieted down. Everyone figured out how to manage themselves with respect to acutely sick patients with COVID. And there were millions and millions of sick patients with COVID. It's pretty amazing that we didn't have complete hospital shutdowns due to hospital-wide outbreaks. We never had them. So we figured that part of the illness out. But what never occurred was a broad-based effort to help people get through the illness at home. I would have expected, you know, 2 years into this, that we'd have outpatient treatment centers. We would have take-home packets of medications, home-based monitoring, phone calls, a broad-based home care nursing program, oxygen at home. I mean, I think almost everybody would say, listen, if COVID-19 is going to come knocking, if they can make it through at home and avoid the hospital, that would be a victory.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's strange that there wasn't, that makes perfect sense to me, that there wasn't an at-home treatment protocol, because most people have that. When they get sick, they kind of know what works for them and how to heal. And a lot of it is rest and time. For me, I'm like overdosing on vitamins, not overdosing, but superdosing. And so we all have kind of our protocols when we get something. And so I don't know why this seemed so different and so much more fear-based, severe, the way that it was spoken about in the press, and people were terrified of getting it. Even healthy people were terrified of getting it.
Yeah, the fear was out of proportion to the reality. And one of the things that you suggested was the fact that an individual could actually themselves alter the potential severity of illness in themselves. And so we learned a lot about the illness in the first few months. For instance, age was clearly a risk factor. We can't do anything for age, but obesity, cardiopulmonary fitness, diabetes, heart disease, lung disease, kidney disease, prior cancer, these were all risk factors. Of those that are modifiable, clearly it was obesity and cardiopulmonary fitness. And I give credit to Dr. Barry Franklin in Southeast Michigan, who I've published with. He's published on a concept called survival of the fittest as it applies to cardiopulmonary fitness. And it is true that the fittest people among us are more likely to survive a pneumococcal pneumonia, a car accident with multiple trauma, a prolonged period underwater. You can go on and on, but there is a tremendous advantage to being fit. And during the course, the first year of the pandemic, I knew I was taking risks. I was treating so many patients with COVID. I intentionally lost weight and really got in shape. I was doing a lot of running, a lot of aerobic and strength activity. I was almost ready to take my hit. And sure enough, COVID came knocking in October of 2020. And I did have some pulmonary involvement, but I didn't get anywhere close to the hospital because I knew that, you know, I had really been working on this. You know, another really interesting factor, since you've brought it up, is an exquisite relationship between vitamin D and COVID outcomes. Vitamin D is an intranuclear hormone, and it works in the nucleus of cells, and it is a steroid hormone. In every study that's been done shows a relationship. The higher the vitamin D intake and concentration, the lower the risk of COVID-19 outcomes. In fact, there's been meta-analysis. There's even been prospective studies. It is a unique relationship. An analysis showed that if a vitamin D concentration was over 50 in the bloodstream, it was nearly impossible to die of COVID. And so we rely on this. I rely on this in my office every day. I measure vitamin D levels. And I said, listen, I don't know if this is therapeutic or not, but I have to tell you, it's so easy to do. Let's do it. And so we've always recommended our protocol some baseline level of vitamin D. And following expert advice and some published data, we actually increased the dose during acute treatment.
Wow. Yeah, this makes so much sense to me. And obviously, I can't claim that this is why I never got it, but I've been taking vitamin D every single day since before this began. And I have not had a single sniffle since this whole thing began. I've never had COVID. And I do consider myself lucky, but I also know I took preventative measures and continue to do so every day because I eat clean, I work out, I take a lot of vitamins, including vitamin D being on the forefront of making sure that I get every day, and along with sunlight, but taking them internally and externally. And so that makes so much sense to me. And I remember early on, they were talking about patients in China who were getting vitamin D intravenously. I think it was vitamin C and vitamin D, perhaps, intravenously. And that article just disappeared, was never reported on CNN or Fox News. And I was like, why aren't we talking about this? And it was frustrating. So I'm so glad you were on the forefront of that. So take me through March to now, because I know so much has happened and we only have 45 minutes to an hour, but take me through what that was like for you, because I know that it actually got controversial and I don't think it should have, but take me through what you did, because you were like, all right, let me help people get healthy, because we're not doing that right now. We're just slapping on some hand sanitizer.
You know, I was just on a podcast with Patrick Bet-David in Florida, the Valuetainment podcast. And they started out by saying, Dr. McCullough, you're controversial. You know, and I thought about it and I said, well, you know, I'm a pretty regular guy. I haven't done anything controversial in my life. I don't even have a tattoo I don't drink any alcohol. I go to church when I can. And, you know, I've been married for 34 years. I just don't see myself as a controversial figure. Now, the question is, did I say anything did I say anything that was controversial? And this was one statement I said, listen, we are going to treat patients at home to help them avoid hospitalization and death. Now, the question is that controversial or should that be controversial? So what the naysayers would jump on this and say, well, listen, what are you going to use? What are you going to treat? And I said, you know, we don't have definitive large randomized trials. They take 2 to 5 years to complete. The guidelines are going to take another 2 years after that based on those clinical trials. So we actually don't have the answer handed to us in the beginning of 2020. So we're going to look for drugs that have a signal of benefit that can address this problem and acceptable safety. As long as they're safe, we're going to give it a shot and put these drugs into combination. And our very first paper was published in the American Journal of Medicine in August of 2020, still the most frequently downloaded paper from that journal for an entire year. It really was explosive when it hit the scenes. It was the first paper that taught doctors how to treat patients with COVID worldwide as outpatients. And it basically said this. It said that we do risk stratification. Not everybody needs treatment, but anybody who's got more than a 1% risk of hospitalization and death, that's typically everybody over age 50, and those who have multiple medical problems, we've gone over them, or those presenting with severe symptoms, and that's an important point, that they should get early treatment, starting with a variety of interventions. Now, we broadly considered things that reduce viral replication, and then interventions that reduce inflammation or cytokine storm, and then lastly, blood thinners, since we learned that uniquely this virus causes blood clotting. In fact, the Italian autopsy studies done very early in the pandemic showed when patients died of COVID, they almost uniformly had blood clots, micro blood clots in the lungs, not ones we could see on CT scan, but it's the small blood clots in the lungs that were causing the low oxygen saturation. It wasn't Wow. like a consolidative pneumonia, or it wasn't like heart failure. It was this microthrombosis, which was very interesting. So we noticed from the very beginning that the low oxygen saturations were far better tolerated than what we would see in heart failure, as an example. It was almost like going to altitude. You know, if you go to altitude at Pikes Peak, your oxygen saturation goes down low 90s into 80s, some people, you know, low 80s, and it's tolerated well. As long as the difficulty in breathing isn't overwhelming, the work of breathing isn't overwhelming, and as long as there's good ability to think, good mentation, that we learned over time to tolerate oxygen saturations far below 94% at home. And in a paper by Fillmore and colleagues from the VA in June of this year, reported that 45% of everybody hospitalized for COVID had oxygen saturations over 94%. So that told me a lot of these hospitalizations were panic hospitalizations. They really weren't necessary. Yeah. They could have been managed at home. Now, fast forward towards the end of 2020, we had come out with our second version of the protocol published in Reviews in Cardiovascular Medicine. I'm the first author on both papers, but the second paper is now 57 authors. And we had a home treatment guide published by the Association of American Physicians and Surgeons, AAPSonline.org. That's been updated multiple times. The protocol now has been copyrighted. It's called the McCullough Protocol, copyrighted in my honor by Dr. Ben Marble and his treatment team. And it is as follows. This is the state of the art, that once we do this risk stratification, if someone is at sufficient risk, we start oral nasal virucidal treatment. This is very important. You do this at home. We use dilute povidone iodine. And so povidone iodine is betadine. It comes on Amazon or buy it at the store in a 10% solution. It's the brown liquid that we sterilize wounds in the ER and the operating room with. It's perfectly safe if we keep it external. We don't swallow it. In fact, there are formulations of this as eye drops, what have you. So it's tried and true. Now, how you do the solution is you take half a teaspoon in 1.5 ounces of water, and that would be a shot glass of water. So we made it easy. Half a teaspoon in a shot glass. Put a pinch of salt in there, just a little bit. It makes it easier to tolerate. And stir it up. And then squirt it up in the nose over the sink. And when you start to squirt it up the nose with a bulb syringe or just a spray pump bottle, which you can also get on Amazon for about a dollar, you start to feel the liquid up in your nose and go ahead and sniff it back all the way back until it hits the back of your throat and then spit it out. And do it on both sides. It's a little messy. That's the reason why I tell people do it over the sink. And do it on both sides twice. And then whatever you have left in the shot glass, gargle with it and spit it out. That's a thorough oral nasal virucidal treatment. And if that iodine can't be tolerated, if there's a hyperfunctioning thyroid nodule or Graves' disease, or if a woman's pregnant, we don't advise this being done in pregnancy, we can use dilute hydrogen peroxide. Hydrogen peroxide comes as a 3% solution. You buy it in the brown plastic bottle over the counter, very inexpensive. And you take 3/4 teaspoon in the same shot glass of water, same approach, and do the same procedure. There are 12 clinical studies supporting virucidal oral nasal therapy. The leads are with povidone iodine, 3 large randomized trials, all showing significant, I mean very large reductions in the rate of PCR positivity. It literally makes somebody non-infectious within a few days. This is very important, so they don't spread the virus as much. And then it markedly cuts down the risk of hospitalization and death. In the published prevention studies, more than 70% effective. It's also preventive. Wow. So if one goes to church or in a congregate setting, they're at high risk. If they did it once or twice a day, it's preventive. But because not everybody gets exposure, the published studies suggest it's about 50% preventive. But the virucidal approach is something that everybody can do. And we know, by the way, people who have taken the vaccine, the virus replicates in the nose just as easily as those who haven't taken the vaccine. That's been shown in papers by Acharian and Rimarisma and Okorsi. I'll say the first author's name so everybody can look this up. Fact checkers can go ahead and verify this. That sure. The viral loads in the nose are the same. The vaccine doesn't stop the virus, doesn't stop transmission. So if I had a high-risk senior, even no matter how many vaccines they took, I would tell them, listen, you go out to church and you come home, before the end of the day, do a virucidal wash. What I've learned from dentists and sinus doctors and others is that this has been used forever for chronic sinusitis, for a deviated nasal septum with infection, and it works for bacteria as well as for various viruses. So I've tried it now a couple times myself with a common cold, and instead of having 3 weeks of congestion and cold symptoms, one can actually get through it in a matter of a few days because the virus kills the virus. A whole variety of viruses are killed with these agents.
This is so interesting because I used to go see a colon hydrotherapist in LA, and if you would get sick, she would give you a concoction. And I, Dr. McCullough, I couldn't tell you what was in it, but I'm pretty sure it was iodine, and you would put it up the nose and you would hold it until it hit the back of your throat, just like you said. And so I would just buy it from her for like 20 bucks, maybe 25, I can't remember, if I had a cold, and it would knock it out in a day or two. And I loved it because it didn't feel great going down the nose, I'm not going to lie, but it's so much easier than anything else. And it worked pretty quickly. So I wonder if it was the same type of, ingredients.
It could have been. Now there are data with people said, doctor, I don't want to do all this mixing in shot glasses. Just tell me what to buy. There are povidone iodine 1% nasal sprays, which is the appropriate dilution of 10% down to 1%. There's a product called Xlear that's available widely. That is virucidal. We know that colloidal silver is, nasal ozone is. It's actually very easy to kill the virus. Believe it or not, Scope or Listerine gargling is effective because you always want to pick up in the throat. And I learned through all this that, you know, when a typical cold starts out with a sore throat, the virus is actually in the lymph nodes in the mucosal tissues in the back of the throat. And it's actually a good idea to gargle. I think everybody should have some Scope or Listerine and gargle at the first onset of the sore throat, any common cold, and certainly with COVID. Now, what else is in what we call the OTC bundle, the over-the-counter bundle? Mm-hmm. So we have to treat the virus in the nasal cavity. We cannot ignore this. This is state of the art, especially with Omicron, which replicates 70 times faster than Delta. And now with the BA2 subvariant, which is even more transmissible. So what's happening is the vaccines are putting ecological pressure on the virus is becoming more and more transmissible. And that means it replicates faster and it's more contagious. So we definitely want to hit the sinuses. And you can do that up to every 4 hours. Now, with the oral therapy, we recommend zinc 50 milligrams a day. It's a polymerase inhibitor, so it has an effect on the virus. Vitamin D we've covered. Now, my current approach is to boost it to vitamin D3 over the counter to 20,000 units a day for 5 days. Now, not forever, but for 5 days. Vitamin C, 3,000 milligrams a day. Now, sick patients, we can use even much higher doses intravenously, which is virucidal, and we can use home care nursing. I know many have done that. I'm an allopathic doctor, so I'm not as skilled as a naturopathic doctor is in working with these, but I know many have done that successfully, and there are supportive data. Quercetin, which is a polyphenol supplement, 500 milligrams twice a day. And then an over-the-counter antacid antihistamine called famotidine or Pepcid. There the dose is 80 milligrams a day. The over-the-counter recommendation is 20, but we go to 80 a day. And that it not only reduces some of the inflammation and histamine release, but it also reduces replication of the virus. That OTC bundle, and the first, that's the top part of the McCullough protocol, can handle the vast majority of Omicron infections. So I can tell you in the last 3 months, my prescription drug use has gone down massively because Omicron is such a local infection in the nose and throat. Now, in a high-risk senior, which I've had now a couple times, and they start to develop any pulmonary symptoms, or I just know things are going to go bad from the beginning, We use sotrovimab, and now there's a new monoclonal antibody by Lilly, bortrovimab, which is actually a very brief IV push, and that can be used down to age 12. These have about an 80% reduction in hospitalization and death. So the monoclonal antibody is very effective. Former President Trump had received a version of this. Governor Abbott in Texas. I went on with podcaster Joe Rogan. Aaron Rodgers from the Packers had texted me. He had received monoclonal antibodies. They all basically received the McCullough protocol and understand that things work in combination. If we can't get the monoclonal antibodies, then we move into the antiviral drugs. In the first year of the pandemic, we relied on hydroxychloroquine because it's pretty much what we had. The second year of the pandemic, we relied on ivermectin. And now the third year of the pandemic, we're relying on Paxlovid, which is the Pfizer drug. The Pfizer drug now has over an 80% reduction in hospitalization and death alone. It's been used in younger people. It's a combination of nelfenpiravir and ritonavir. And it's reasonably well tolerated. There's some drug interactions we have to watch out for, but it's manageable. I think a weak second choice is the Merck drug, molnupiravir, because it's only 30% effective and it has some cancer risks to it. So I think Paxlovid is the way to go. Now, we combine it with doxycycline and azithromycin because it has those have some mild antiviral capabilities, but they also cover bacterial superinfections and actually co-infections, including mycoplasma and chlamydia pneumonias. And then we use inhaled budesonide throughout. And then if pulmonary symptoms develop, we use oral prednisone or dexamethasone. Colchicine throughout, particularly those with underlying lung or thoracic disease, because it reduces the pleural pericardial manifestations and well supported in a large randomized trial. And then after that, we're down to blood thinners. Aspirin 325 a day for everybody is good. Our Italian colleagues are using 700 milligrams a day of aspirin because that's how it comes there. That's fine. And then if there are immobile seniors, nursing home residents, people in wheelchairs, people have already had blood clots, I don't fool around. I put them on Lovenox, 1 milligram per kilogram twice a day, or oral anticoagulants such as Eliquis, Xarelto, Pradaxa. Now, that's a lot to consider. It's called sequence multi-drug therapy, so skilled doctors can do this. And when it's done, I've testified in the Senate recently on January 24th. I told America when it's done, my estimates are that 95% of all hospitalizations and death are avoidable.
When Luca's mom was diagnosed with an autoimmune disease, she ran from doctor's office to doctor's office, getting more and more prescription medicine while her health just got worse, which is exactly what happened to my mom when she first had multiple sclerosis followed by cancer. Every pill introduced a new side effect, and every side effect warranted a new pill. It was a vicious cycle with no healing in sight. In Luca's case, his mom found a different route. She found a doctor who specialized in root cause medicine. After 12 months, she completely reversed her autoimmune condition. And her son Luca began to think, why isn't all of medicine this personalized and data-driven? And why doesn't everyone have access to this type of information? And that's when he created Index Health. Stories like these remind me of why I do this show, Food Heals Nation, and why I love Index Health, which you can learn more about at indexclinic.com/foodheals. With Index Health, you get access to board-certified functional medicine-trained doctors and functional-trained nutritionists who use advanced lab tests to diagnose and treat chronic conditions. All treatment plans are 100% personalized, and doctor appointments are 1 hour long. They really take the time to deep dive into their patients' health. I only wish that something like Index Health was around when my mom was sick. To schedule your first appointment, visit indexclinic.com/foodheals. Again, that's indexclinic.com/foodheals. Food Heals Nation, if you're like me, you know that drinking enough water is imperative for our hydration and our detox. And I personally try to drink half my body weight in ounces of water per day. But have you thought about the quality of water that you are drinking? So according to the Environmental Working Group, virtually every home in the U.S. has harmful contaminants in its tap water. So ditch the tap water, ditch the cheap water filters, and check out my favorite water purifier company,
AquaTrue. You can visit aquatrue.com, use the coupon code FOODHEALS for 20% off any AquaTrue purifier. AquaTrue purifiers use a 4-stage reverse osmosis purification process, and their countertop purifiers work with no insulation, no plumbing. I set it up myself. Don't worry. It's easy. It removes 15 times more contaminants than ordinary pitcher filters and are specifically designed to combat chemicals like PFAS in our water supply. The filters are affordable and long-lasting. No changing filters every 2 to 3 months. AquaTrue filters last from 6 months up to 2 years. AquaTrue comes with a 30-day money-back guarantee and even makes a great gift. Today, my listeners will receive 20% off any AquaTrue purifier. Just go to aquatrue.com, that's AquaTrue.com, and enter the code FOODHEALS at checkout. That's 20% off any AquaTrue water purifier when you go to aquatrue.com and use code FOODHEALS. Heels Nation, do not hit the skip button because I'm about to tell you the most amazing recipe I've ever made, and you're going to taste test it with me, okay? This is the creamy, decadent Organifi chocolate mousse. I'm going to teach you how to make it. We're going to taste it together, and I'm going to give you a coupon code, of course, at the end so you can make it yourself, and it's healthy. The recipe is by Drew Cannoli. You know him from Food Heals many years ago. He was on with Susie and I, and I'm happy to report that he's coming back. That was definitely a fan favorite. If you want to go back and listen, it was a fun episode. That was the only episode where Susie ever asked a guest to marry her, okay? But you have to go back and listen to hear that moment. All right, so I made the creamy, decadent Organifi chocolate mousse. This is from the Organifi website. I'm going to read a little bit from the blog because it's very true. Divine decadence, sultry satisfaction. It honestly doesn't matter what words you use to describe this drool-worthy dessert. Heck, given Organifi Mousse's health benefits, you don't even have to deem it a dessert because it can be enjoyed whenever you desire. So dig right in. Okay, so that's from the blog. And it's true. Okay, first let me tell you the health benefits of this mousse. So this is, you can fool your kids, you can fool your husband, you can fool your friends. They're not going to know this is a healthy, delicious dessert. So when those kids are like, mommy, we want dessert. Or when your inner child is like, I'm tired, I want dessert. This is it, okay? So you're going to put the Organifi green juice into the recipe, which gives you some amazing health benefits like boosting your energy and brain power, helping with your mental clarity, providing your body with healthy nutrients like the electrolytes in the coconut water, helping to reduce stress, promoting healthy skin, hair, and nails, and detoxifying your body and helping to flush toxins out. The next ingredient after the green juice is avocado. Of course, you know avocado, very nutritious. Has tons of nutrients and vitamins, 20 vitamins and minerals to be exact. And of course, it's a rich source of antioxidants like vitamin C and vitamin E. Raw cacao, yum. This is where it gets the chocolatey flavor, made from the cacao tree, one of the best sources of antioxidants on the planet. All right, let's get into it. Here's the ingredients. I just made it. It's so easy to make. 4 medium and ripe avocados, 1 scoop Organifi green juice, 1/3 cup raw coconut nectar, 1/2 cup raw cacao powder, 1 teaspoon of vanilla extract, a pinch of salt, and you know, if you want to garnish it with some strawberries or nuts or fruit, or if you have some like vegan whipped cream or something you want to put on top, that's optional. Okay, it's literally the easiest recipe I've ever made in my whole life. Blend the avocado in a blender until it's smooth. Add the other ingredients until the blended avocado, it kind of makes a blended mousse. Okay? So easy. Now, you got to chill it in the refrigerator for about 2 hours to make it taste really good. There's also a hack to this. This is what I did. I mixed ice cubes in it so that it would be chilled. Okay? So, you do you. That's what I did. How easy is that? You want to taste it with me? It's divine. Oh my god. This is so good. Food Heals Nation, you got to try it. It's one of the best recipes I've ever made. They've got more recipes on their website. It's a great way to get your greens on. And if you want to get some greens right now, go to OrganifiShop.com/foodheals. And when you go there, you're going to see my little picture pop up, and you can use the coupon code FOODHEALS to get 20% off your order. So get the green juice, put it in the avocado mousse, and change your life. That's all I'm going to say about it. You're going to change your life. Again, it's OrganifiShop.com/foodheals. Use the coupon code FOODHEALS. You'll get 20% off your order. Make the mousse. Tag me on Instagram. I want to see your pictures. I want to hear how you loved it, because I know you're going to love it. All right, now back to my interview with Dr. McCullough. And so if someone's listening right now and they're like, wow, Dr. McCullough just dropped so much knowledge, gave us so many treatment healing protocols, what should I do? Should I call my doctor and ask for these? Should I go to the website? I know you have the McCullough report on AmericaOutLoud.com/the-McCullough-report, which I'll put in the show notes. But what should a patient do if they're like, all right, I've got it. What is my next step?
I think most seniors should understand, if you have seniors who listen to it. I mean, people over 65. If someone has not taken a vaccine since October 1st, they're essentially unvaccinated. And even if they have taken a vaccine, what we understand is the protection is negligible at this stage, that they're at risk. And particularly those who haven't had COVID, they're still susceptible. So I think everybody ought to give a call to their primary care doctor and say, listen, we're 2 years into this. You know, are you treating COVID? You know, are you ready to go with the drugs and sequence? You know, do you follow, you know, a protocol? The McCullough protocol is one to follow. The FLCC protocol is another to follow. AFLDS is another. You know, do they follow one of the suggested protocols? If the doctor says, no, I don't, or I'm not comfortable, then you say, well, who do you refer to? You know, who's your referral source? And doctors have a duty to treat. And if they don't treat, they have a duty to refer. And I think I really want patients to start driving their physicians a bit on this. A lot of patients have given up on their doctors. They've been going to telemedicine services. They've been doing all kinds of workarounds. And we need to bring the conventional primary care doctor back into the fold. We're at a low point with COVID right now. We've gone through the Omicron outbreak and we're at lower levels, but now we see it firing up again in China and in East Asia, and there's reports that now it's the BA2 subvariant of Omicron, which is more transmissible. So I think we're going to potentially have another swing through, and it may be our older, more susceptible people. Now, you mentioned something at the very beginning I want to touch on. You mentioned you never got COVID. And, you know, the CDC in their herd immunity estimates has always said 15% of people can't get COVID. They simply can't get it. And there's been some papers, one by Lindner and colleagues, suggested maybe that part of it is cross-reactivity with other coronaviruses. And the prototypical person would be a mother or a daycare worker who gets tons of exposure to lots of little kids with colds. And they literally become immune due to cross-immunity with so many other coronaviruses. But the leading theory on this has been proposed by Dr. Sabine Hazen out in California, Ventura Hills. And she has found that it's the microbiome. It's actually the constellation of bacteria. Now, she does research on stool samples and uses the GI tract microbiome as a proxy. But the microbiome from the nasopharynx to the intestine, it changes, but it is contiguous. And so there are some ways to score the microbiome. And those who have a very favorable microbiome score, she's studied family members who have been in a household where everyone's sick around them with COVID and they don't get COVID because they've got a healthy microbiome. And what that means is the virus just can't set up shop and replicate and really take over because the natural bacteria are defending the body.
Yeah, I mean, that makes so much sense to me. And as a person, and as you said earlier, you know, the more fit you are, the less likely you are to get it suffer. I am that person. And so my immunity is constantly being boosted. I'm very aware of my microbiome. I'm always taking my probiotics and doing preventative measures so I don't get sick. And this whole time I haven't been around children. I've been around friends or family members, but I pretty much I was alone for the first, you know, I don't remember now, 3 to 5 months of this, because I lived alone already. And so they said, stay home and don't see people. And I did what they told me to do. And then when I started going out into the world and I got on planes, trains, automobiles, started traveling again, I was like, all right, this is it. If it's coming, it's coming. And it never came. And I think it's because I'm just constantly super boosting my microbiome, boosting my immunity, all that good stuff. And so I'm absolutely a fan of doing whatever you can at home. And then I also wanted to ask you about the three things you mentioned earlier, which were the ivermectin, the hydrochloroquine, and the antibodies, because like I know our mutual friend, Jeremy, who introduced us, he swears that his father was saved by the antibodies. And I know people who have talked about the ivermectin absolutely being a game changer, but why were they so controversial, and why weren't they allowed to be talked about, and how do they work? Do they work, and how do they work?
Well, let's take the monoclonal antibodies, which are fully emergency use authorized. We've gone through two different products with Lilly now, a wonderful combination product with Regeneron, which was our workhorse, and a GSK product that is showing good efficacy even against resistant strains. The monoclonal antibodies are a product of Operation Warp Speed, and they're nothing short of a miracle. I can't imagine that I'm treating a viral infection with a specific targeted antibody that's safe and effective, it's easily infused, and it literally neutralizes the circulatory viruses in the bloodstream before the virus does too much damage. And so I can tell you they are miraculous. And what's frustrating to me is, why weren't they advertised on TV? Why weren't there 1-800 numbers to show where our high-risk seniors could find them? Why weren't there monoclonal antibody infusion centers? I know Governor Ron DeSantis went nuts down in Florida. He said, listen, we got to feature these. This can't be a secret. They've been grossly underutilized. In a paper in Medical Economics in November of 2020, it was announced that the U.S. had already purchased 100 million doses and had 500 million doses on order. I mean, that is more than enough to treat every high-risk person we ever had in America. And sadly, they haven't received it. And, you know, the hospital administrators and doctors have been focusing on the wrong stratification metrics. How many times have you heard about hospitalizations and then someone will announce, well, it's mainly among the unvaccinated? And I say, listen, the vaccine isn't a treatment. You want to hear how many people are hospitalized who got the monoclonal antibodies and how many are hospitalized without the opportunity to receive monoclonal antibodies, because that would have been the operating metric to improve. So if hospitals were hospitalizing people without giving them monoclonal antibodies, you know, that's what could be improved in community care, not a vaccine. A vaccine is not treatment. And so you can tell that they're focusing on the wrong things. They kept reporting hospitalizations by vaccine status. I said, that's a waste of time. Why don't you tell us who got the monoclonal antibodies? That's the missed opportunity. I'm looking carefully at all these hospitalized reports. I think virtually everybody hospitalized has been denied monoclonal antibodies, and it's really a shame.
It's a tragedy.
In fact, hospitals should give them in the ER. Now, hospitals have said, well, we can't give it in the hospital because the emergency use authorization restricts us to an outpatient. I'd say, fine, give it in an ER to meet the criteria, and then you admit them if you want to. But denying people monoclonal antibodies has really been a tragedy. And then the other thing in the inpatient care, which has been a disaster, is the use of remdesivir. Remdesivir is an intravenous polymerase inhibitor. In the clinical trials, it resulted in more deaths compared to placebo. And in 2020, the World Health Organization says, don't use it. Don't use it. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, the hospitals in the United States have not followed the regulatory guidance on this. They still give remdesivir, and sadly, people still go into renal failure or liver failure, and they pass away. It's really atrocious. So now patients have been trained to go into the hospital and absolutely deny remdesivir and do not let them try to put that in the IV solutions and things like this, because the hospitals are getting a financial bonus, and many times they're giving remdesivir against people's wishes, or not telling them, or just assuming it's okay. And so this is a terrible practice. Remdesivir should be removed from the market to remove this hazard from our seniors in the hospital.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, this sounds criminal to me. I'm like, this is unacceptable.
You know, I have to say that the oblivion in treatment has, I think, attributed, I think we're approaching nearly a million people have lost their lives in the United States. And now we know about 95% were preventable. It means millions and millions of hospitalizations were avoidable. And everybody in the hospital basically has either been denied access to or has not gotten early treatment. Now, you asked about hydroxychloroquine in the published studies, outpatient meta-analysis published by Dr. Ladapo, who's now the Surgeon General in Florida, and myself, showed that hydroxychloroquine is about 25% effective. It's kind of modest, but it does have a beneficial effect. Ivermectin, supported now by over 70 studies, over 33 randomized trials, has about a 55% benefit. So ivermectin is more diverse. And interestingly, it's more diverse inpatient and outpatient, where hydroxychloroquine did relatively little late in the disease. Ivermectin seems to work through the entire range of disease. It's diverse. Wonderful paper called the ICON study, published by Dr. J.J. Rochester from Florida, published in Chest, one of the best journals, showed that inpatient use of ivermectin worked great. And the saddest thing is that hospitals across the United States deny patients inpatient ivermectin. The American Medical Association has an official campaign they announced in September to abolish the use of ivermectin. So as patients are denied ivermectin, they continue to be hospitalized. And when in the hospital, they tend to die. And so these efforts to block early treatment have really been harmful to Americans.
And so 95% of these deaths are preventable. Who dropped the ball? Like, in your opinion, like, is it the government, the CDC, the hospital staff, the media? Like, what is it that is behind all of this that is causing this amount of ridiculous numbers of 95% of these deaths were preventable?
It's all of the above.
It's all of the above.
Can you imagine? We are 2 years into this. We have thousands and thousands of local broadcasters across the United States. Mm-hmm. They never give an update on early treatment. They never give updates on what you should do when you get COVID. People sit and watch TV all day long. All the major networks have never given a comprehensive update on what you should do if you get COVID. Our public health agencies have never given updates. Our medical schools have not held local seminars. The public health agencies haven't. To this day, someone who tests positive for COVID, they are given no instructions on what they should do at home. And so it is an absolute mess. And I can tell you now, I'm going to give a big public seminar tonight in Fort Worth. But I've given seminars now in over 2 dozen major cities. Thousands of people come out. And we go over the data. We go over the supportive studies, the protocols. People want to know what to do at home. And I was recently on this podcast I mentioned, and I told one of the young podcasters, I said, what have you done? Have you held regular updates to help your listeners? Yeah, and he kind of looked at me like in a blank. And it's most media people have not fulfilled their public health duties as media people to bring new information about early treatment forward. The medical schools haven't, the hospital systems haven't. It's been a complete and total failure across the board.
Food Heals Nation, did you know that Americans spend an average of 90% of their time indoors and take about 20,000 breaths per day? According to the EPA, indoor air is 2 to 5 times more polluted than outdoor air, and in some cases, this is scary, up to 100 times more polluted. The data shows that air pollution is responsible for nearly 7 million premature deaths globally. That's why it's so important to filter the air in our homes. You remember my story after discovering toxic mold in my home almost a year ago, I realized the importance of having multiple high-quality air filters in my home to protect myself, to protect the air that I'm breathing and the air that my beagle Lily is breathing. Think about everyone in your household, your family members, your roommates, your kids, your cats, your dogs, your pets, right? We have to be so conscious of the air that we're breathing inside. But that's why I'm obsessed with Air Doctor. You can visit airdoctorpro.com, use the code FOODHEALS, and you can get up to 39% off an air purifier. Air Doctor filters out 99.99% of dangerous contaminants and allergens like pollen and pet dander and dust mites and mold and even bacteria and viruses, so your lungs don't have to. It's so easy to set up, it's quiet, and I can rest easy knowing I'm breathing cleaner air every day when I'm working from home. If you work from home like me, you gotta filter your air. So head on over to airdoctorpro.com, use the promo code FOODHEALS, and depending on the model you pick, you'll receive up to 39% off or up to $300 off. This is exclusive to Food Heals Nation listeners. You'll also receive a free 3-year warranty on any unit, which is an additional $84 value. Check it out by going to airdoctorpro.com, airdoctorpro.com, and use promo code FOODHEALS.
This episode is brought to you by the Weather Channel app. Did you know the app can help you forecast more than just the weather? With allergy tracking and flu risk mapping. So you know when to stay inside and load up on podcasts. As well as air quality and UV indexing. So you know when to get outside, load up on sunscreen and podcast. Forecast more of what you love with the Weather Channel app.
All right, Food Heals Nation, I'm sorry to end the interview here, but there is a part two. It's just too hot for Food Heals. It's a little bit too controversial, but it's definitely information that I know you want to know and that I really want to share with you, but I just can't risk it on the main Food Heals feed. As you know, I've been censored. As you may or may not know, Dr. McCullough has been censored. He is one of the doctors that was talked about in the press, in the media, after going on Joe Rogan's podcast. I think that he's a man of science, a man of data, and I think that he is a world-renowned cardiologist who has a true goal to help people. I think the rest of the podcast is a must-listen. But because I'm not willing to get censored on these platforms like YouTube, luckily, Spotify isn't seeming to do it to health podcasters. Other platforms are. As you know, I was censored by my own software for talking about vitamins and vegetables, nothing even controversial. And so in order to continue to bring you the latest, best, cutting-edge health information that I can't afford to get shut down. It's not worth it to me. So that's why when I have a guest or information that may now be considered controversial, although I don't think it is, I think it's health information that we all need to know. From now on, I will be putting it behind a $5 a month paywall. That is to protect me. And that's just a great place where you can go and get loads of extra content. So if you love Food Heals, if you can't get enough, all the extra content will be there. It's not all going to be controversial stuff. Some of it is fun and lighthearted. So you'll get the best of both worlds. I think the information is imperative. I would spend the $5 just to listen to that interview. And if you don't want to be in the VIP club, you cancel tomorrow. I don't care. But I want to put the information out, but I don't want it to go to all the podcasting platforms. I don't want it to go to YouTube. I don't want to get too big so that I can get shut down. So I hope you understand. I really, really do. I don't want to do it this way. I would prefer to say everything on the main show. However, the powers that be are cracking down on creators and podcasters and people and brands like myself. I'm not the only one this has happened to. Now that I've been going through the debacle with my software, I found some private messages that had been sent to me on Facebook. I didn't even know that were there. And it was other people saying, this happened to me too, here's my story. They're shutting down coaches, people in the spirituality realm, people in the health and wellness realm. I'm not the only one that this is happening to. Kind of makes me feel better, but also scares me on a bigger level because I know if it's happening to little old me, it can happen to anyone. And so to avoid it from continuing to happen or happening again or happening on this platform, on this microphone that is my life, blood, my blood, sweat, and tears I put into this show to make for you for free forever. you know, I have to protect myself and protect the show by putting certain content behind a paywall. I hope you understand. I love you guys so much. So go to glow.fm/foodheals and you can sign up to be a member of the VIP club. What happens is you'll get access not only to the interview with Dr. McCullough, you'll also get access to all the content I've made since I started in, I can't remember, it was 2018 or 2019. So all this back content that you're welcome to go and listen to. And it covers all kinds of things I'm interested in. It has interviews with people who are on the show. And then we kind of go behind the scenes. Okay, we talked about wellness on Food Heals. Now let's go behind the scenes of how you built this business, right? So I have a lot of those types of interviews. Then I have a lot of sections, or what should I call them, clips from my mastermind, from Food Heals U, Food Heals University. I have some clips from my courses, like Food Freedom. And so there's just a lot of information in there. There's a lot of interviews, and there's a lot of just privately me talking. And lately, I just started sharing juicy stories from my life. So another story I'll be sharing is how I was recently attacked in a Facebook group. I was in the Facebook group trying to help people and share what had happened to me. And I got a lot of support and thank yous, and wow, we had no idea. And, you know, I was helping people navigate, you know, how to not let this happen to them. And while I was doing that, there were three women who were trolling, attacking, and just coming after me. So I'm going to share that story in the VIP club as well. So yeah, there'll be personal stories in there, and there will be behind the scenes in there. There will be stuff that's too hot for Food Heals because I don't want to get censored. And there's a lot of fun, great interviews in there that I think you'll enjoy. So check that out, glow.fm/foodheals, $5 a month. If you're feeling generous, you can donate more. It always helps me. It just goes back into making the show better for you. I don't know if you noticed, but I've released like 6 shows this month. I want to help. I did a bunch of interviews, so I'm happy to provide those for you. So what does Dr. McCullough talk about in part 2? He talks about the V, I hope you know what I'm talking about, and the efficacy, and what are the results showing, VAERS, you can look that up. And he just breaks down the data and what they're seeing so that you can make an informed decision about your own health. And it's really good. I think it's definitely worth a listen. I probably already said that. So in order not to ramble on, I will just tell you another update is that if you're following the censorship debacle, which you can follow at foodhealsnation.com/fightcensorship. Ooh, I do have an update. I haven't even posted it there yet. But originally, when I got the first email that said your email is shut down, they said I had too many spam complaints, okay? So I'm thinking, that's weird, because I've been sending the same type of emails for 6.5 years. First, I was on ActiveCampaign, then I was on Kartra. Never once did I get, oh, you have too many spam complaints. So why all of a sudden was I over the spam complaint threshold? And by the way, what is the spam complaint threshold? How many spam complaints does it take to get shut down? Well, I found out. I thought hundreds. I thought thousands. It was 19. I got 19 spam complaints. So what does that tell you? That tells me that this is not about the spam complaints, because that is clearly not enough based on the thousands of people that I email for it to be red flagged. This tells me that it is the content, but the content hasn't changed. So I believe it's a sign of the times affecting the companies who are going, well, we're not going to be associated with this content. So you get a spam complaint, you know, you're red flagged, we look at it and we decide ourselves and you're out. And that's what they did. And I talked to, I think I mentioned a second ago, a couple of people on Facebook who this happened to too, with the same software. And at first they would blame the spam complaints, but then they learned it wasn't about that. That was just the cover. That was just the like beginning, because what they really were censoring were the topics. They don't want to be associated with certain topics that they don't believe are, you know, whatever. I don't know what they think. So that's the update on that. So for anyone who said, oh, you weren't censored, which people in the Facebook group said, you weren't censored, you had too high of spam complaints. Sorry, but 19 is not high compared to the thousands of people that I send emails to. So that was BS. So yeah, I'll be doing an episode more in depth, and I'll be sharing stories of other people that this has happened to with their permission in the VIP club as well. And if you want to stay up to date with the censorship debacle, I post updates at foodhealsnation.com/fightcensorship. And I would love, 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 if I've ever helped you in any way and you want to make a donation today, it really, really will help me with these, with the whole switching platform process. It has been an expensive, time-consuming process that I hadn't prepared for, you know? And so every little bit helps, and I'm giving back to you. So as you know, I've been cleaning out the swag closet. So for every $10 you donate, you will get an entry to win a swag bag full of my favorite organic, vegan, sponsored products. So, you know, over the last 4 months of living in my new place my Airbnb in Nashville, I collected quite a bit of product from, you know, if you listen to the show regularly, you hear all the sponsors that I have. And so, yeah, it's exciting. I've got all this stuff. I can't wait to send it to you. So all you have to do is go to foodhealsnation.com/fightcensorship, make a donation. $10 is one entry. $20 is two entries, $30 is three entries, and so on and so forth. And every single time I get a donation, I am so grateful. I'm in so much gratitude that you guys want to help me with this. It really, really fuels my soul. Like, it just reminds me that I am supported and that I'm doing this for a reason and that you guys do support my mission and my vision. So yeah, if I've ever helped you in any way and you want to win some swag, I would love a donation. I can't tell you how much it means to me. Follow Dr. Peter McCullough on Instagram at Peter McCullough MD. Follow him at Twitter at P_McCullough MD. You can listen to his show at americaoutloud.com/the-McCullough-report. And you can hear part two of my interview with Dr. McCullough in the Food Heals VIP Club for $5 a month. Go to glow.fm/foodheals. See you next time, Food Heals Nation.
These statements have not been evaluated by the Food and Drug Administration. This podcast is not intended to diagnose, treat, cure, or prevent any disease. Side effects of this podcast may include increased health and vitality, thoughts of living longer, developing a more positive outlook on life. In rare cases, people have experienced a strong desire to actually start using their $39.99 a month gym membership. If you experience any of these symptoms, Snapchat your trainer immediately.